we will compromise on the fact we won't hide it because
no. He looks like he's had it.
Yeah, I think we both enjoy it because, of course, it's a big moment, but it's also hard. You know, it's hard to keep fresh.
The same story over and over again.
Yeah, sometimes sometimes you go on different directions. That's what I try to, so it kind of stays as fresh as I can, but.
It's hard. So this is kind of an amazing Dogma film.
No, it
isn't. This is all handheld camera. It was pretty impressive.
But you know, the thing in life is that you have to challenge yourself. Making a Dogma film was a big challenge. Because it's like if you're a writer and you decide to write everything in hand, it's a challenge.
Yeah.
But it gives you something as well. Making a Western for Dane, it's another challenge, and I like challenges.
So, where did this idea begin?
It began in, like every idea, it begins many places. But if you take physically, me, Christian Levering, making a Western, it began in Soho, London. Uh-huh. Me and Peter Olbeck, the man from Zumtopia, talking about where our love for films comes. We both the same generation, and when we were in the 60s and 70s, children, mm-hmm. we had only one television channel in Denmark. You can't imagine that as Americans, but that was the true one channel.
We only had four.
Okay,
back then,
we had one.
Yeah.
And on Saturdays there was only one kind of movie, westerns. So that's your first love, your first love of the media, the mm-hmm. first strong emotional reaction. Comes from there. And we were talking about that. We were talking because I've always continued. I just like love Western. I love John Ford. I don't know if Peter had too much Barolo or whatever happened, but he said, Christian, I think you should do a Western. And that was like quite a mad thing. But of course, me being a Western lover, I said, yes.
So did you grow up on color Westerns or they were all in black and white when you were watching on TV?
We didn't. First of all, Danish television didn't screen anything in color when I was a child. Secondly, so we didn't have a color television. So I much later realized that, for instance, Her Yellow Ribbon, that was actually in colors, or The Searchers were in colors. I saw them black and white, but of course some of them were in black, like Fort Apache or Stagecoach or My Darling Clementine, which are some of my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, My Darling Clementine, or I would say Man of Short Liberty Valance, the Searchers, those are films I never get out of my head.
Well, the color scheme you chose, though, for this movie is kind of like the early three strip process, but
yeah.
a like, hyperactive version of
yeah.
it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Was that a decision of an homage to the period, or was that just what you were drawn to?
The genre, the Western genre, is a colorful genre in its narration. Mm-hmm. So I felt I want to do a very colorful film to bring, that's kind of striking colors into it. And of course, there's different Westerns as well. Like mm-hmm. Robert Altman did a fantastic Western called McCabe and Miss Miller, which is very realistic.
Yeah.
But that was not the kind of Western I was doing. I tried to work more like in the more mythical kind of Western. So I wanted that kind of, über life or whatever you call it. That was kind of an important part of it.
So did you ramp it up in post, or was it, how much of this was in camera, color wise?
It was a mixture. I spent a lot of time on color schemes and stuff like that in production.
Mm-hmm.
These are things that matters to me, So and then we also did we enhanced that in post.
And it was, how much of it was shot on location?
Everything.
All
shot.
Of it. It was yeah, all
yeah.
of it was.
Yeah, yeah. It's actually even the interiors. Mm-hmm. We built them. We didn't shoot in studio. We built the interiors almost like a location.
Mm.
So that you are inside a house when you're actually. I think that's something that really helps the actors.
And so you actually built houses and stuff? You didn't go to the kind of famous locations that exist, the few Western towns that are left?
No, because, no, this is a strange thing. We couldn't afford to do this film in the U.S.
So none of it's in the U.S.?
No.
Oh.
It's shot in
Where is that?
South Africa.
Wow.
We couldn't afford to go to the U.S. You know, we sent the script and we got budgets and I come from a tiny country where we don't have the amount, the big budgets you have in the States. Mm-hmm. And so we had to find an alternative, and I spent some time traveling on Google Map. Mm-hmm. You know, because you have to find a place where there's an industry. Because you know you need horses, you need makeup, you need costumes, you need the things you need. So I looked, and that means you can, like, 95% of places in the world you can't go.
Right.
And then you end up with five. And then I start looking out different Australia, Croatia. Like Leone shot his westerns in Spain.
Right.
So South Africa. And then we got finance.
But the mountains here were pretty stunning. I don't think those are in Spain as much.
They added.
Oh, they added. The mountains are added. Yeah. Okay. So you're on location, but you're adding mountains. And you're
We had to add a little bit of Americana and cut out the African trees.
So did you just go shoot plates, or did you use existing footage, or?
No, we went to Utah, mm-hmm. a place where I used to when I did commercials. I used to work quite a lot in Moab, Utah. That's a fantastic place called Dead Horse Point, mm-hmm. which is kind of a legendary place. And Ford shot quite a few westerns out there, many. So we went and we photographed. What you do is that you photograph the buttes. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to take the kind of Monument Valley buttes because they're so overused. So there's some other ones that I remembered that we went and we photographed them from all different angles. And then in 12 different stops, and then you add them in.
It reminded me a little of some of the Silverado shots.
Yeah, yeah.
More than other Westerns I've seen.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes, yeah.
And was the decision, did you make a decision to kind of take the tropes of Westerns and to try to break them a little bit and to find another way out of them? Or, I mean, like the shooting through the roof and having the consequences be a little different than usual, normally in a Western.
Yeah, but of course I think when you make a Western, you make a genre movie, and there's loads of cliches in the genre. And the important thing is to love the cliches, but to play with them, to have fun with them, mm-hmm. and not be scared of them, but of course not just to repeat them, but to play with them. And I tried to do that as best as I could all along. And but I also tried something which I think Europeans sometimes forget. I tried to work with the fact that this period, this time, America was kind of developing into this big nation that it is. Mm-hmm. And Europeans sometimes forget that that's also our story. Mm-hmm. You know, it's part of our story. Because when a Dane or a Spanish or Russian or Polish mm-hmm. went to America, they brought something of themselves with them. But the fascinating thing I find is that although they are Danes or whatever they are, in 1 minute, almost, they step out of the boat, ship, mm-hmm. they're Americans. Although they don't even speak American. And that's because there was no way you could go back. So they had no mm-hmm. choice. This is my country, this is my land. And all these people, they brought something with them. And that's something I find that's a part of that story that I find fascinating. Mm-hmm. I would say that's why I have a right to make a Western as well, because that's kind of my, way into it.
Well, your lead character really learns the lesson of America, the unhappy side of America, but pretty quickly.
But the frontier side, because at the same time, which we mentioned a little bit as well, you would have the eastern cities, which were very highly cultivated and very civilized places. I mean, and places of modernity.
Yeah.
And that's for us European. That's what's so different for us. It's like that in the same country at that time, you would have almost like that in one place, and then we had something almost like anarchy in a different place.
The distance was a little different back then.
Yeah, of course, of course.
The other side of the country was another planet, really.
Yeah, of course.
So Mads was the obvious, easy choice for this?
Yeah, we wrote the part for him. You know, as you know, I'm Danish, and it like to play a Dane. And it, also, we talked about it while we were with him, while we were writing it, that it, it's like, he's just the perfect man to be in a Western.
But he's very, his ability to kind of jump from character to character is kind of breathtaking. I mean,
he's a fabulous actor. You know, he's a special one.
Did you shoot this before he moved to Canada?
Or? We shoot it in between.
In between?
In between one and two.
Seasons one and two.
Yeah,
and two.
Yeah.
So did his perspective on being in North America, at least, was it different at all? Or was it, you had spent some time, you had spent a lot of time here yourself, so.
Yeah, in America, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think it was that you would have to ask him about that. We talked a lot, but we also talked about that whole thing of being an immigrant, you know, coming, making a new life in a new place, which in a totally new world. But for us, it means something else, because we can go and on Google Maps and we can have a look at how the place looked. Mm. You know, when these guys went into the wilderness.
Mm. Well, I don't think they were expecting there were people who would just kill your little son,
no,
kind of on passing.
Of course not. And of course that happened. When you read about some of these places, yeah. I mean, the amount of people that did get killed were quite pretty, I mean, not amazing, not quite incredible, actually.
So was Ava actually anxious to play a silent role?
I think when we talked about it, she, of course, I sent her the script, and I think she like, in a way you could say, like doing a Western, it's like, that was a challenge. She found that challenging thing for her as an actress, to not have her voice. How do you get things across? You know, how do you get emotions across? And we talked a lot about that, and you know, how we could make this, you know, how we could make it strong. I felt that also that there's some kind of irony, because in Westerns a lot of time women talk very little. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, we had this idea that okay, we this one she can't even speak, you know, they're taking her tongue as well.
But she says a lot without her.
Yeah, that's the, but that's because she's a great actress.
Yeah. Jeffrey Morgan was a kind of a gutsy choice, I think, on some level. He's not the biggest movie star in the world, but what was it that drew you to him?
I've seen his work, and I just thought he has that capacity of both bringing, because he's a pretty bad guy, Delarue. He's not the nicest man in the world. I think, but Jeffrey brings in something that, in some strange kind of way, you still like him, and I felt that he could do that. And it's almost impossible to like a guy like that. You know, it's like,
yeah.
But there's something in him that I think. But that's always the hard thing with villains. It's not to make them too one-dimensional.
Well, I think that's true of all of your characters. I mean, even the good guys are a bit ambiguous.
Yeah, yeah.
A lot of the time.
Yeah, but I like that. that's how life is. I mean, there isn't such a thing. It's very rare. Of course, there are some real villain people.
Yeah.
But they're not that interested. It's interesting to look at. And are there is there such a thing as only a person that's 100% only good? He only does good things? I don't think so. You know, I think everybody has demons, and some people are much less than others. But
the politics of being out there in the prairie is not a pretty thing.
I think it was very hard. You know, I think. I think we have to remember that. I think we have to remember every day how important civilization is, you know, how important law and order is. How if you always take your own revenge, it can leave a scar on you. And law and order is an important thing to prevent you from that, protect you.
So is it been, is it felt, was it good to get good back in the stirrups, as it were, doing a feature? I mean, you've been doing the commercials and things like that.
But that's a long time
ago. It's been a little while.
Yeah, I haven't done
so. You haven't done commercials in a while?
No, I haven't done it since 98, 99. So.
Good Lord. That is a long time. But yeah. You also haven't made a feature in a while.
Nope. I didn't because I was, I took some years with my kids. I was fortunate enough, I did commercials for some years, which allowed me, which had the bad thing about it was that I was working more or less like a crazy. And then I couldn't spend enough time with my children. So I took a little bit of time off to be with them.
So good to get back to it?
Yeah, it's nice. Now they're bigger now, you know, so they don't need me as much.
You can bring them along as grips.
Or makeup artists.
Or makeup artists. So was it, I mean, is doing a picture, you've never really done anything, you've done actually some road movies, but yeah. You haven't really done anything of this kind of scale.
No, I did that when
visual
I did,
scale.
When I did that when I did commercials. You know, I worked with what I call the big tools. Mm-hmm. But to do this movie, one of the fun things was to do a movie with the big tools, because the Danish movie I've done were with quite small tools, you know, so it's like, it was like bringing the craftsmanship or whatever you call it that I learned from doing commercials into the, you know, to try to have the possibility of making a movie with that craftsmanship was like.
So you get a lot more money in a commercial, I assume, than you ever had for this picture.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, of course,
it's insanely big budgets for commercials.
What? Yeah, yeah. But especially in the time I did commercials, you know, I think it's changed.
I
think
a little bit.
It's gone down. I don't think commercials are the same. It hasn't got the same hype as it used to. So I think companies spend less money on it because in the 80s and the 90s, it was pretty crazy.
So is Cannes the first stop for this picture?
For me, it's the beginning because you see when you, I had never imagined this film would come to Cannes. That was the first thing because I never made it with that kind of, I just never imagined. So when Peter and Caesar came to me and said, "Christian, we're gonna try to get it into Cannes." I said, "Are you crazy? This is pending. They're never gonna happen." But you know, then it did happen, and they chose me for this thing, the midnight screenings, which I felt was like spot on, because it's like that's great for this movie. But of course, you know, being a director, you know, being here with your movie, it's a big thing. You know, it's. But what does it mean? It means that now, I literally finished the movie 10 days ago.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So it's like, now it's going on its own journey. Mm-hmm. And this is like the first station. It's a nice station, but where it's leaving from. And it's like, it's a nice place to kind of let it move on from.
Did you watch it last night with the audience?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So how was that for you?
But that was, you know, it's always a weird thing because when you watch your own movies, but with an audience for the first time, but I mean the applause I got, and you could kind of feel it was a real good feeling in the theater. And it sounds very like I'm praising myself, but I mean that's what people applaud for a very long time, and of course that's very moving.
Yeah,
you're standing there, you don't know what to do, and Matt said because Matt know me, and he said, "Matt, Christian, don't walk away now. Stay up here, enjoy it. Let these people allow them to clap their hands." When they stop, you walk away, and that's what I did.
Has any of that changed for you over time? I mean, you've been doing this for a long time now. Has that interaction with what the film is after you're done different for you at this age?
Of course, the first time it's traumatizing, then it's a little less traumatizing and a little less. But you see, the thing about me, what I love about movies, about making movies, I mean making films, is making them. I actually really, really enjoy shooting, editing, writing movies, and this film was a little bit special in the sense that it was actually a lot of fun to do. We played with, we all had fun, you know. Mm-hmm. Jeffrey came on and shake my hand every day. "Christian, we're doing a western, man. It was like we just had fun, you know. And that's, of course, not all movies are fun. Some of them are extremely tough, and that's the nature of it. But this one was just a fun one. So it's a nice one to leave also.
But you don't get a huge amount of gratification from you know, the ultimate box office, or that's not your prime. I mean, obviously it helps you make the next movie, but
yeah.
That's not where you get your jollies. You're done with the movie.
But of course you want people to see what you do, you know, but it, and of course it's so many thoughts and ideas of how to do this and that. You don't do it like in a limbo where, right. Of course you think about audience all the time, and you should do that when you edit, so it's really hard to explain, but because of course it's wonderful you do movies so people see them. That's the reason why you do them. But I think it's important that there's also some enjoyment in the process. If that isn't there, then it becomes too calculated or too harsh. And also, ultimately, that's not what life is about. Mm. Life is about enjoying what you. And listen, I'm an extremely privileged man. I do what I love to do. And if I didn't enjoy that, I should be ashamed of myself.
Did you ever have a moment where you were sucked into that thinking?
Oh yeah. because you know, making a film is also loads of your fear. I mean, I'm Danish, I'm making a Western. Of course, there's a lot of fear in that. There's a lot of moments where you go, is it gonna work? Will people buy it? You know, of course, and fear. But when I say enjoy it, I really mean that. But what you should not do is that you have to be in doubt 23 hours and 55 minutes every day about what you do. Because if you're not in doubt, then you take it way too easily. You know, it's doubt, is this good enough, is this right? That's part of it. But you have, in some strange way, you have to enjoy that doubt. You know, enjoy it, because it's like, you have to enjoy it. Because if you're not doubtful as a director, or anything, a writer, or whatever you do in life, if you're not doubtful about what you do, I don't think you're very good at it. I mean, that's just my personal opinion.
Well, I saw the picture on a stream because of the timing of everything of this.
Yeah.
And I got to say, there's nothing I really want to see more on a big screen during my trip. I'm kind of like figuring out exactly how I can get to it.
Because
you want to, the minute you see the first frames of this picture, you're like, oh my God, I got to see this on the biggest screen with the best sound. And,
you know. That's what I try to do.
It just seems like joy. It feels, you can feel the joy. You can really.
But Westerns were the first genre of the movies. You know, it was first films that were made were Westerns. And I there's a love in that. I just feel that kind of, that has to be in it. The working with the landscapes, with all these things, it has to be part of it.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
I hope you have something you can use, and I hope the sound was. I tried not to.
I think we did okay. Everybody cleared out, so.
Yeah. And I tried to raise my voice.
Thank you for making that work.
It was. Well, they brought in the background as we went. It was like a Wes Anderson movie.
It was like the reverse junkie.
We have a continuity problem.
Yeah. Yes, well, we run them uncut.
Thank you.